Okay, so the next topic is about file sharing. The next and the last topic in chapter 10 is about file sharing. So file sharing is generally when if multiple users collaborate and work together on a project, they will want to share their files. So because in order they want to reduce the effort which is required to finish the task, computing task. So in that case, so in a multi-user system, when multiple users are working together, it is sharing of files is very much a highly desired option. So when you do the task of when operating system implements file sharing, then there are so many aspects which has to be considered. So in this topic, we'll just explore through the various types of options available, what are all the problems which will be encountered and how it can be enforced or implemented. All that is being learned in this topic. So first is about multiple users. So if your operating system is going to accommodate multiple users, then it has to implement, it may be required to implement file sharing. And if it implements file sharing, it has to implement file protection. So how is it going to implement file protection? One way is, let's say one user is requesting for access to a file, file of some other user. So one strategy is, provide default access. Whichever user requests for access in a multi-user group, then provide by default the OS may provide access. The other way is the users can be specifically granted access to the files. That means depending on the user who is requesting it, he may be or may not be granted access. So for this, conventionally the strategy which is followed by most of the operating systems is the users will be categorized into different groups. Okay, so it uses the concept of file owner, group, and other users. We would have seen this concept when we are working with the ls-l command in Unix operating system. When you give ls followed by -l, it lists the types of files and the permissions which are given to the files, what are all the types of users, every information is available. So there are, in many types of operating systems, there are three types of users are classified under three categories. One is file owner, second one is group, and the third one is everybody else in the universe, all other users in the universe or the world. So who is this file owner? File owner will be the one who will be having most of the control over the file, and he can grant access, or he can deny the access, or he can change the attributes of the file. The second one is the group. Group will be a subset of users who will be able to do subset of operations on the file. Let's say if I have a book file, then if I'm the file owner, I'll have all access, like I'll have read access, write access, execute permissions. If it is group may be someone who is helping with me with the file operations, then I can decide to give only read and write access to the group users. All other users will be the one who will be using the book file. So I can give only read access to all other users. I don't want to give them write access or execute permissions. So these are the three categories of users, which is generally categorized by the operating systems by which file protection is enforced. Another way in which file protection is generally enforced is by use in a multi-user system is by using owner IDs and group IDs. Okay, for every file, there will be a owner ID and group ID, which is stored along with, generally we know that attributes for a file will be stored in the directory structure. So along with the file attributes, for every file, the OS will maintain owner ID and group ID. Owner ID is the owner for that file, and group ID is a set of users of a particular group who are allowed to access that file. So when a user is requesting for access to a particular file, then the OS will compare the owner ID of that particular file with the user ID of the user who is requesting that file. If both of it matches, then the OS will decide to grant access of the file to that particular user. If it doesn't match, he will be denied access. Same rule applies for group also, group users also. Group ID of stored in the file attribute will be compared with the group ID of the user who is requesting the access. So resultant, if both are same, then he will be granted permission. If both are not same, he may not be granted permission to access the file. So this is how multiple users file sharing is being enforced. The second is about remote file systems. So now we know that networking has advanced to a very large extent. You can have networked computers in many different parts of the world. You can have a computer in, you can have a machine with a file system in China. You can have a file system in US. You can have a file system in India. So the computer system, if the country allows, if there is no restrictions, then the computer system which is in China can share its file system with any remote machine in any part of the world through the concept of networking. So that type of file system is called as remote file system. Okay, remote file system helps us to are nothing but the file systems which are shared across the world through the concept of networking. Okay, so there are how to implement this remote file systems. Remote file systems are practically done by using, commonly done by using three types of methods. One is in that is in olden days, it was done by using FTP protocol. By FTP stands for file transfer protocol. So manually files are transferred between machines by using FTP protocol. The client will issue the request and the server will send the files through the FTP protocol back to the client. The second type of remote file sharing method is by using distributed file systems. Now, what is the meaning of this distributed file system is we'll be having a centralized server which will be storing the files. Okay. And any client on the network can request for the file if it has the proper authorization rights. That is, after satisfying this authentication methods, if it has proper authorization rights, then any client on the network can access the files which is stored in the centralized server. So here we can have one centralized server or we can have more number of centralized servers, and it can be accessed by, so by that, any file system which is access, which is present in a remote machine can be made available in a local machine. The third way in which remote file systems were being implemented is by using the World Wide Web. We know that in a World Wide Web, we need a browser. Browser will act as the client and browser will send requests to the server for access to any particular file on the file system, and the server will check, search and return back the request back to the client. So here, when we are doing this file transfer by using FTP, it can be anonymous access. Anonymous access means that the server can send the files to the client without having any account on the client machine. So these are the three commonly used types of remote file system file sharing methods. So this remote file systems are implemented by using two types of implementation. Okay, one is the client server model and the other is by using distributed information systems. Okay, so let's learn about these two types of models. One is, there are two models for remote file systems. One is the client server model and the other one is the distributed information systems. Both are two types of implementations for implementing the remote file system concept. So first one is client server model. What is the meaning of client server model is, you will have a client machine. So you'll have a client machine, you'll have a server machine. So the one which is having the data or the file is called as a server, and the one which was requesting for that file system is called as the client. So here the server can send the file systems to the client in remote way. Okay, the computers will be connected through the networking in spread across the world, and they'll be connected through networking, and then the server can send the remote files to the client. So this is called as the client server model. So here this facilitates many to many relationship. That is, many servers can service many clients, many servers can send files to many clients at the same time. And how authentication will be done here is, the server will specify what are all the files which is available with itself in its volume, and the client can be authenticated by using its network name and by using its IP address. We can have a combination of network name and IP address to decide whether it is the proper authorized client or not. If you want, sometimes yes, IP address spoofing can be done, right? So if you want more authentication, client can be authenticated by using encrypted keys. So with all that, server can authenticate the client and send the requested files to the client. And one example of this client server model is the network file system called as NFS, which is used in the Unix operating system. Okay, so here in network file system, authentication takes place through the client's networking information. What do I mean by that is, there will be a user ID of the client. For any user, there will be one user ID in the client side as well as in the server side. Okay, so when any user requests for access to a file, the user's ID on the client and on the server, both are checked for matching. The user's ID on the client and the server should match. Let's say if user is requesting for a file on the server, the user's ID on the client, if it is 1000, it should be same 1000 on the server also. If both the user IDs match, then only server will grant the file access to the client. Otherwise, if the user IDs don't match, server will not grant the file access to the client. So this type of authentication is called network file system authentication, because it makes use of the client's networking information to enable the client to access the file. The other type of remote file system implementation model is called as distributed information system. So this is nothing but it just provides some sort of additional help. So in order to make the client server systems easy to manage, what it does is it makes use of a service called as domain name system. Already we would have learned or heard about this domain. We would have been familiar with this domain name system. So this domain name, what this distributed information system do is, it just provides some operations to make the client server systems easier to manage. What it does is it makes use of domain name system. What does this domain name system do? It converts the host names to network addresses. What do I mean by host name to network addresses? Let's say I'm the user. I go to the browser and if I want to browse google.com, I'm not going to type the IP address of google.com or the network address of google.com. I'm just going to type the host name, which is nothing but which will be just a user identifiable name like google.com. So that host name google.com will be translated to a network address or to the IP address of the google.com by this domain name system. So by this domain name system helps for easier managing of this client server model. Okay, if I want the user to remember the IP address of all the websites which he wants to browse, it is going to be an impossible task. So just because this domain name system exists, we are able to translate the host names to network addresses, and it provides for easier management of the client server system. So other ways which are used by distributed information systems is by using a combination of username password, or by using a combination of user ID password or group ID password. With that also, easier management of client server systems can be carried out. For example, Sun Microsystems has introduced something called as Yellow Pages, which is also called as Network Information Service, which is being adopted by the industry. Okay, which is called Yellow Pages or Network Information Service. So this is being this Yellow Pages has been introduced by Sun Microsystems, and what it does is that all the usernames, host names, printer information, everything will be stored in this Network Information Service, in this Yellow Pages. Okay, so whenever the user wants to access some resource, then it will be compared with this Yellow Pages directory, and then authentication will be carried out, and then you will be granted or denied access. Another example of this distributed information system is Microsoft's Common Interface File System. Okay, for the client server model, we saw an example which is Unix Network File System. For the distributed information system, we have an example which is nothing but the Microsoft's Common Interface File System. This is also similar to Network File System of Unix. What it does is the user's username, the user's password, as well as the user's network information. These three are combined to create something called as network login. Okay, based on the user's network information, username and password, a network login will be created. With the network login information, server decides whether to give access to a file system for a particular user or to deny access. Okay, so if for a proper authentication, usernames, passwords, as well as the network information, everything should match. So for that, what Microsoft does is, it maintains the information about this username, password, and the network information of the user in something called as domains or an active directory. So in this domains or active directory, all the client information is being stored, all the username, password, and the network information of all the users will be stored, and that is used to authenticate the users. And another another standard which is adopted by the industry is called as Lightweight Directory Access Protocol, which is called in short as LDAP. Okay, this is a Lightweight Directory Access Protocol is nothing but a protocol which is it's again a distributed mechanism used by the industry. So where what happens is, again, this is made use of by Sun Microsystems. So what it will do is, there will be one distributed LDAP directory. In this LDAP directory, all the information will be stored, all user information, all resource information for that, for all, for that particular organization will be stored, all user information and all the resource information of a particular organization will be stored. And when any user wants to access a particular resource within the organization, he has to do one-time sign-in, single sign-in. So one time, if he is authenticated, he will be able to access the all the resources with present within the entire organization. Okay, one time he has to sign in, it will be authenticated with the lightweight directory access directory. It will be authenticated with the information in the LDAP directory. Once he passes through the authentication, that user can access any resource present within the organization, because all information is stored within the LDAP directory. So that is all about Microsoft's Common Interface File System. So to summarize, we saw file sharing is nothing but when multiple users are working together, they are required to do file sharing, and we have many aspects in file sharing. When we have multiple users, file protection is enabled by using the concept of three types of users, namely file owner, group, and other users. And it is also, file protection is also enforced by using, by storing owner ID and group ID along with other file attributes in the directory structure. The other way, the second one is, second aspect of file sharing is about remote file systems. Remote file system means computers spread across the world will be able to transfer their file systems to any remote machine via networking. That is done by using three methods. One is by olden days, it was done by using FTP protocol. Second is distributed file systems, where we'll have a centralized server which will store the data, and remote clients will be able to access it. Third is by using World Wide Web, where you will have the client or the browser which will request the information, and the server will send the file request back to the client. And that is implemented by using two types of models. One is client-server model, and the other one is distributed information systems model. In client-server model, many servers can send files to many clients, and the authentication is done by using the client's network name and the IP address, or by using encrypted keys. And one example we saw about network file system in Unix, where again the networking information of the client along with the user ID is being used for authenticating the user. The user ID of the user on the client as well as the server, both should match. If it doesn't match, the user will not be granted the file access. The other type of model is by using distributed information systems. This is nothing but, this is not a model, it just facilitates easier management of client server systems. That is done by using domain name system, where all the host names, user understandable host names, will be converted to network addresses by the domain name system. Another way to make easier, for easier management, is by using a directory like Yellow Pages, which was introduced by Sun Microsystems, where all the usernames, passwords, will be stored for all the users, and authentication will be provided. So here in distributed information systems, one example is Common Interface File System in Microsoft, where the user will be authenticated via his network login, where for every user a network login will be created, which will contain the network information of the client, of the user, along with his username and password. So one real-time implementation is the Lightweight Directory Access Protocol, which was introduced by Sun Microsystems and currently used by the industry. So here, all the resource information, all the user information, everything will be stored in the LDAP directory. And whenever the user wants request or access to any resource, by resource I mean the files here. Whenever the user wants access to any file, one time he has to do sign in, and this will be checked against the user information stored inside the LDAP directory. And if he's authenticated, then he will be able to access any resource present within the entire organization. So that is all about the concept of file sharing.